player two has entered the podcast.
Let's go. Welcome back, people, to Player Two Has Entered the Podcast. I am your co-host, Michael Peterson, a.k.a. MC Paper Stacks. And with me, as always, is my co-host with the co-most,
Derek Merkison, a.k.a. Full Metal Merc, a.k.a. the Merc Man.
And Merc Man, this week, we got some very special guests with us on the podcast. Some fellow podcasters. Yes, we do. Call It Like I Don't See It podcast. Host AD and GP. GP, are you with me?
Oh yeah.
We end the podcast. We ain't going nowhere. Snap. So I would like to introduce, we got AD. Say hello to the people out there.
What's going on, y'all? It's your boy AD, a.k.a. Arinus Maximus Derilius. I just had to steal that one. I like how y'all do our intro.
Tight. All right, GP.
All right, what's up, everybody? This is GP, a.k.a. Mr. Ham and Cheese, a.k.a. the Game Killer. What up?
All right, and we are super happy to have y'all on. We'll get into talking about your show in a few, because I'm excited to tell everybody what y'all are all about. But let's just jump right into it, man. How's everybody's week going? What y'all got into this week?
Yeah, excited to be here. That's what we're excited to be here.
Yeah, first time as a guest.
Yeah,
cool. The week was pretty good.
Yeah, well, let me tell y'all what I got going on real quick. I forgot to talk about it before, but I just recently, actually last night, I started trying to figure out how to do Amazon FBA, Fulfillment by Amazon. Mm. Man, that shit had me confused, but I figured it out. I got my boxes and all my shit shipped out there, so a lot of my stuff should be Amazon Prime eligible. So I'm about to get this money.
You about to get that next day shit, okay.
Super quick. Yep. Right. I said now. I got it now.
Open my door. Bring it up to my tub and serve it to me while I take a bath.
Bring it up to my tub.
Get
pass
out
my
tub
toilet
with
paper
me.
At the same
bring
time.
It to my quarters.
Pass the toilet paper too while you're at it.
Yeah, I ain't got anything really cool going on like that, but I'm still not drinking soda. So just like last week, I've given up soda completely. I really severely reduced my caffeine. I had the first cup of coffee in a week last night to stay up with y'all. We'll talk about that in a bit. I also been kicking up my fasting game. So I talked about how I only eat within an 8-hour period lately. I've been eating from noon to 8. And I've been actually shedding a few pounds doing that, because I'm getting my metabolism in a certain rhythm. I even went for a longer fast. I actually fasted for 40 hours earlier this week. So I went from Sunday night all the way up through Tuesday without eating.
It was that superhuman strength. I can't do that at all.
Well, the stick the next time I see your ass.
Yeah, man. Well, the toughest thing was actually I was having caffeine withdrawals because I was still addicted at the time. Mm-hmm. But I finally got over my addiction through that. But the hunger, it's funny. You would think you would be hungry the entire time, but it came in waves. And it usually happened around the time I would normally eat. But if I just wait a couple hours, you know how like you'd be at work and it's lunchtime, but you're real busy or whatever, and you end up skipping it, and then you end up not even being hungry in the afternoon. You get back hungry again at dinner.
Yep.
That's So like, it's like your body will produce this chemical called ghrelin that tells you you're hungry. But again, they don't throw it at you all day. It's just around the usual time. I'm going to try to see if I can fast like over 3 days, because I hear that past 3 days, your body stops throwing that ghrelin at you until you really do need to eat. And at that point, it'll throw it at you again, and then you know you can end your fast. But a lot of people can fast anywhere from like a week up to a month. I don't know about a month, but
I always found that amazing, dude. Like,
How like religious people do it?
Yeah, I'm like, dang, you could do that thing for like 30 days straight. Jeez.
Right, you just gonna sit there and not eat?
I don't know how you do that.
No, there's, I mean,
be done for 30 seconds. They're like, I gotta eat right now. I'm sorry.
Yeah. You know, back when we were younger, they talked about breakfast being the most important meal of the day. And some folks were like, oh, that's a conspiracy by the cereal companies. I used to think that was silly, but now I'm like, there's a lot of research coming out about the benefits, the health benefits of fasting. And it's pretty interesting. So I will keep y'all up to date on my fasting journey. Wish me luck.
Okay. Man, good luck. How to you? That's great.
So I got some interesting pickups from Gamefly. Gamefly, I'm quickly realizing, is the place to go to for used games, y'all. Because they give you the full package with the manual, everything but the plastic wrap. They sell the used games for, you know, fairly cheap. Ain't no stickers, a bunch of junk on them like you get at GameStop, right? Mm. I picked up SpongeBob Battle for Bikini Bottom on Switch for $14.99.
Nice.
I got Doom Eternal on PS4 for $20. And I got Destroy All Humans on PS4 for $17.99.
Is that the remake?
Yeah, that's the re-release.
Okay, re-release.
Nice.
Yeah, so
awesome.
Yeah, and I've also previously picked up Maneater and Resident Evil 3. I did it too early because they keep dropping. I think Maneater was under $20 last time I checked, but I think I picked it up for like $30.
Damn. Oh, nice. I hope they do that with PS5 games soon. When
it comes yes.
Right? Yeah.
Please. Yes. That price.
Pretty please.
I bet they will. I bet the price on certain games on PS5 will drop pretty quick, just like they do in the current generation. I ain't holding out hope for Switch, but, you know, that Nintendo's a different beast. We talked about that before. But
okay.
I'm still trying to catch up on Lovecraft Country. Any of y'all finished the show?
Yeah, I finished it.
I haven't even watched the show yet.
Yeah, I haven't touched it yet.
You should check it out. It's pretty good. It kind of jumps the shark a little bit. There was this episode with just a whole lot of booty play. I was like, I don't know about that. My wife was like, that's grotesque. But when we
that's
got
what
past,
you watching?
Oh, you in here? Well, she watching it with me, but she was like, I don't know about this. I don't know about this husband. I was like, just
close your eyes.
Just close your eyes, wife.
After that fifth booty, I don't know if we
yeah, too much booty in
it. Just, and it wasn't just about the booty. You know I'm about the booty. It was the booty abuse. Be nice to the booty. Be kind to the booty.
The booty abuse.
The booty is mine. It belongs to me. You cannot violate my boo-hoo-ty. Anyways,
careful, you almost went to R. Kelly.
I know, right?
Somebody,
I felt it. I felt it coming on. I felt the R. Kelly coming on.
Booty is more important than water. It's more important than food.
Is that how you fasted? You just swap food.
Yeah, booty. Just eat.
Just eat booty, for 2 days. You will sustain on the booty. If you see my wife, she can feed me for a few days on that booty. Don't worry about it. She gonna listen to this and either love it or hate it. I don't know.
Scientific facts to us about how he fasted this whole time. It's just nothing but booty.
Nothing but booty. My secret's been revealed.
Substitute food with booty.
But yeah, I got to this episode called I Am, and it was all about one of the side characters in the show and how I don't want to completely ruin it, but there's a conversation she has with her husband that's like really powerful. And I think a lot of couples, especially older couples, should watch, of how you can get in a relationship and shrink for the other person. And it, she went into like African war and she like learned how to fight. She danced on stage in Paris with Josephine Baker. Like she did some really cool shit. And it was just like really empowering and really cool to see. I can't really explain it. It was definitely like Afrofuturism, that type of episode. Like it kind of felt like when I was watching Black Panther. I really enjoyed it. So
honestly, I didn't like that episode.
You didn't like I Am? Really?
Nah, it was too much of her, man.
Too much of her. I was into her as a character. You didn't like her as a character?
Nah, not really.
Fair enough.
Especially where the story was at the time, then it just switched over to her.
Well, I mean, they did the same thing with the previous episode with Tick's ex-girlfriend over in Korea.
Yeah, but that had Tick in it.
Yeah, also had a nine-tailed fox. That was crazy, by the way. Look, I don't want to say anymore because we're going to ruin the show like we did the first time we talked about it. But
you're talking about Inspired. I just finished up on Megalobox, that anime.
Mm-hmm.
The boxing one with the mecha stuff. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Dude, I felt super inspired after that thing finished.
I did
a full set of like 20 push-ups. I was like, this is great. this is great. Like the way the characters developed throughout the whole season was just awesome. But the major hit for me is the soundtrack, dude. It's like, you know, that hip-hop Japanese rap. I'm like, what? This thing is dope as hell. Like, I think the kid actually dropped some lyrics in the episodes too.
Okay. Tight.
But
yeah,
the action at the end, the fight at the end, though, was like so dramatic, but I'm not going to throw any spoilers out there because I highly recommend watching that anime, though.
Yeah, no, I'm sold. Derek and I dipped our toes in it briefly. Derek, did you ever finish it?
Yeah, I finished it.
Oh, did you dig it too? Or?
Yeah, it was just okay to me. It was kind of like a cowboy.
Derek, why are you hating on everything today?
I don't know, man. You know my bar.
Yeah, that's true. Derek absorbs a lot of anime. Yeah.
When you finish Full Metal Alchemist, you know how high the bar is.
Yeah. We're not going to be doing the Derek X Mike anime challenge this week, but stick with us because we're going through that show episode by episode, and it is getting good. It's true.
Yeah.
I want to check out Megalobox. You know, I miss music like what Nujabes used to do for like Samurai Champloo, right? That Asian hip hop vibe. I love Nujabes.
That's exactly the vibe that series had, dude.
Yeah, I definitely want to go back and check that out. I watched the first couple episodes and I was digging it. Mm-hmm. So cool. That inspires me to try to pick that back up.
You'll at least get to do 20 push-ups to go with your diet. Trust me. You do 20 push-ups with it.
Well, that's important. When you're fasting, you do want to keep exercising because your body could switch to trying to eat your muscle instead of your fat. If you stay, what's the word I'm looking for, where you just kind of sit on your ass all day? not lazy. Sentient.
Lethargic?
What's the word?
I know what you're talking about.
Couch potato?
Sedentary?
Sedentary. Thank you. You stay sedentary. You know, you're just sitting on your ass, not moving. That's right. The word of the week.
The word of the week, right there.
Sedentary.
Yeah. Sedimentary. Thank you. As soon as we say it, we'll Google it and say it right. Kids, Google the word of the week. Okay. So, but yeah, that sounds cool. What else we got going on this week?
Oh, man, I put my face back in that burger that I told you guys about.
Oh.
That garlic butter bacon burger, baby.
Garlic butter bacon burger.
Garlic butter bacon burger. I shoved that thing back in my face 2 days in a row, man. No shame. No shame whatsoever.
Man, I had a fat burger in a minute, y'all. You said it was a Sonic, right?
Yeah, at Sonic, dude. Like, you gotta get on this thing just the way the grilled onions, like, just the flavor of it, how it just juicy garlicness. Every time I start shaking and when I start talking about it, like, I'm really holding myself. I'm trying to hold myself together with my words. Like, oh my God. My wife was so, because she went out, it was yesterday night, and I texted, I was like, yo, I could really go for that burger if you want to pick it up for me. And she's like, but you just had it. I'm like, is that bad? She's like, yes. Well, still get it for me though. I'll take the guilt, but get it for me, please. But yes, I had to. I had to sink my face back in that thing.
All right.
I mean, I would have bought some for you guys for the show right now, but, you know.
Yeah, I don't know how that would, that'd be like a 2-day air. I don't know, man. How that burger would last. But well, we got Sonics here in Indy. We can head over to Sonic. It ain't no thing.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Well, one more thing I want to talk about, because we need to move on to the next segment, or this is going to be a 3-hour episode. Which, ain't nothing wrong with that.
Ain't nothing wrong with 3 hours, baby.
Borat 2 came out. I don't know if y'all heard the news. Borat 2 came out, and at the very end, they had Rudy Giuliani in that movie. Did y'all hear about this?
Uh-huh.
Yeah, I saw a brief article.
God, I watched the video, because they have the clip up on YouTube right now. Boy, woo, that's a bad look. So he's basically like flirting with her. I mean, she's flirting with him too, to be fair. She's touching on him and stuff, but he's just like, yeah. And then they get alcoholic drinks. They go to a dim ass bedroom in this hotel by themselves. They take their mics off. I don't know why. And he lay on the bed, reaching down in his pants, talking about, oh, you know, later on, he was like, oh, I was just trying to, you know, tuck my shirt back. Boy, you went
Giuliani?
Yeah, Giuliani? But get your dick wet. Yeah, exactly. Oh, yeah.
Don't put your face in that. No.
Now, if you remember Borat 1, he tricked a politician into chasing him around the room with his ass out, and that ended that politician's career. But it is 2020, so Rudy Giuliani will probably be president next time. I don't know.
Right. Yep. Yeah, possibly. Yep.
But
that's how the world goes.
Saw you on Borat, Mr.
He's
president.
Leading the polls right now, as you just mentioned that.
He ain't even running.
He up 8 points.
They're going to have to reanimate him. He's going to be like a cryogenic head by the time he runs for president, his old ass.
Futurama shit.
Yeah. So yeah, if you're interested in some like fantastic cringe humor, look that shit up. Or even check out the movie. I heard it's all right. It's not as good as the first one, but could it ever really be? I don't know.
Yeah. It's on Amazon Prime, right?
I think so.
Yeah, it should be.
Yeah.
Check that out.
All right, so what we've been playing this week. Derek, what you been playing this week?
Some more Crash Bandicoot 4. It's about time.
About time, baby.
Yeah, I had to switch it from retro to modern mode because I kept on dying.
Yeah, we talked about that last week. Yeah. Would you die like 100 times? You're like, nope, this ain't for me.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I finally got to play as Neo Cortex, and he's trash.
So. Oh.
those levels are fun. Mm-hmm. But I'm just chilling, man. I ain't did a whole lot of playing this week. I've been working.
Yeah, we all played a game together last night. We'll talk about that last, though. GP,
man,
what you
think you're going
to
bring it in, but I'm just like, can we talk about
he's
it yet?
Like, no, he's like, yeah. AD over here in front of his mic, just like double dutch, like, can I get it?
How about so fast?
GP, what you been playing this week?
Been just playing the thing we're going to talk about. That's about it, really. I haven't been playing anything. I've been working nonstop, too, so.
Man, I feel you, definitely.
Damn, work. Work, why you gotta exist?
Yeah. Work always coming. Come on, get out of here, work.
Yeah,
get out of here. We need to all quit our day jobs to start that drip squad. We talk about, what was it, Driptastic 4?
Driptastic
4. Driptastic 4, baby. We got shirts.
We got merch.
Go to driptastic4.com for the merch, baby. That's pending. That's not actually up right now.
Well,
don't
besides
go
that, I've been playing. Like,
don't Google Driptastic. Call of Duty.
Call of Duty. All right. Yeah, that's season 6. Mm-hmm. I just started using this legendary Ufaga gun. It's a growl. So damn dope.
Wow. Yeah. Okay. Cool. Cool. All right. Well,
serious kill streak.
I've played a few things. I've been still been playing Fire Emblem Warriors because I'm on that kick trying to like max out all the characters or whatever. Like I'm working on their weapons really hard. I'm grinding. Sometimes I don't understand how people. Yeah.
Nice. Got that beat. Grinding on his flow.
Grinding and I get all my characters shining and I grab all weapons. But yeah, sometimes I don't understand how somebody can play a game for like hundreds and hundreds of hours. But for like warrior styles games, when they're really good, like Hyrule Warriors or Fire Emblem Warriors, I do put in the time. I really do. It's like my Zen game. I get in the zone, you know, I get in that flow.
Yeah,
and I'm just killing like thousands and thousands of dudes. I love it. Love those games. So I've been playing that Monday Night Brawlers. I played Cadillacs and Dinosaurs arcade game. Y'all ever play that?
Yeah, I played it with you.
No.
It's pretty good. It's a Capcom brawler from the 90s. It's bananas. There's Cadillacs. Okay. There's dinosaurs. You know what
you
it is.
You said Capcom, so you're in good company right there.
Yeah. Cool. They even got characters. They even got like bad guys that look like Blanca, but they got like acid instead of electricity. Like they biting off their own stuff so hard.
Sold already.
So yeah. I had to play it on a main emulator though, so it's not like you can go out to the eShop and grab it. So just keep that in mind. But
so is that like a Power Stone type brawler?
No. It's like it's more like Streets of Rage. Right? Yeah.
Ah, okay.
Yeah. You threw a throwback there with Power Stone, bro.
I know, right? Yeah. Way back.
Power Stone, they need to bring that back. Power Stone was fun as hell. That was a good party game. Mm-hmm.
All these damn remakes, they need to remake that. Bring that thing back.
For real. Yeah. That was a great formula. I would love to play like Smash Brothers spinoff in the style of Power Stone, man. I think that would be cool. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
That'd be nice.
So, Friday Night Frights, for this past Friday, I played Outlast 2. I don't know if any of y'all played that. I played Outlast 1 before, but I had never played Outlast 2. It is bananas. We in the mountains trying to research this woman that came out looking crazy and pregnant and barefoot. Like, what's wrong with her? And then the helicopter goes down, and the first thing you see after the crash is the pilot just strung up, skinned alive, just bits and pieces hanging out. I was like, oh, this is graphic, baby.
This is spooky horror, man.
And you got not one, but two crazy religious cults just fighting each other on the same island, and they all don't like you. And I'm like, damn, I gotta be in the middle of this.
Shit, that's not a good situation at all.
No, that's completely different
from the first Outland.
Yeah, there's a little bit of a religious connotation in the first one, because you have like a priest or whatever, but they didn't like go into it. They go all in. I'm talking, there are crosses everywhere, even in the logo. I'm like, okay. So, yeah, I think I'm going to keep playing that the next few Fridays, because I doubt it's going to be that long. It's probably like a 6 to 8 hour game. I need to look that up. But anytime a game is like under 10 hours and I'm digging it, I'll go ahead and play it all the way through. Like I played Until Dawn all the way through, Man of Medan, Resident Evil 3 on that show. So this one, I think I might go ahead and finish. My mainstream is still playing Hades. Hades is amazing. Y'all ever heard of Hades?
Yeah, I heard of that one recently too.
I finally watched the trailer for it. I was like, oh, this shit looks dope.
It is.
So I'm about to hop on it.
If anything, Supergiant does really good with their art, their story, especially their music. Like, I'll jam to their music just on Spotify while I'm hanging out working. They got good tunes. But, yeah, what I like about it, I mean, I'm into roguelikes anyways. You know, like, you're buying Isaac, Rogue Legacy, Dead Cells, stuff like that. But what sets this apart is while you do, you know, your subsequent runs and you try to get as far as you can before you die and you start over, dying is a part of the story because you play as Zagreus, Hades' son, and you're trying to escape the underworld of Hades. And each time you die, you get sent back. And they're like, oh, what got you this time? The Bone Hydra? Chump. You know. And you develop relationships with the gods on Olympus. They send you different powers. Those powers can grow, that type of thing. So there's a whole lot of progression. And I found out that's what was missing from my roguelite. This is probably one of my favorite I've ever played. And each new run just feels fresh and different, and I'm excited to like kind of get to know these powers and try different combinations and things. So I'm into it.
Nice.
Hades is still kicking my ass though. Every time I get to my dad, I'm like, oh, this motherfucker. Yeah. Okay. Here we go.
What difficulty y'all normally play y'all games on?
You know, we talked about this recently. Derek, you go first.
Normal. I ain't got time.
Yeah.
I got the time. Yeah. Derek told me he had usually normal, sometimes easy, depending, because you know, time is a factor. We try and get through all these games.
Yeah, that's true.
I usually try to do the recommended difficulty, and then if I feel like it's too easy, like when I was playing Ghost of Tsushima, I move that up to lethal. because it was too easy for me after a while. Mm-hmm. And Lethal did kind of make the gameplay feel more hype. It made some of the duels frustrating, like that duel to get the Kensei armor or whatever.
Yeah. Hardest duel in the game, bro.
That was the hardest duel, yeah.
I spent a half hour trying to beat that dude because I went in there without any resolve, and I was like, I got to go get some resolve.
Yeah.
Yeah, man. You need to get your resolve game up.
Yeah, you got to.
Straight up, straight up.
I do. What about y'all?
What about y'all, your difficulty?
I normally play hard and just regular hard. I don't go the hardest of the hard and all that, but just regular hard.
Cool.
It depends for me, because like God of War, like I have a history of beating every God of War on the hardest difficulty. So, and the one that's going to come out next year, I'm definitely going to just start that thing off on the hardest level.
Right.
But Jedi Fallen Order, that one was like normal. I was really like feeling to do hard on that one. But yeah, it depends. Like it is a time factor. Like if I got the time, I'm going to put it all the way up.
You know what? You know, it's not just time too, because like you said, it depends on the game. I feel like it's how well the game is made, because Ghost of Tsushima, the combat is tight.
Yeah,
like you could rant and rave about that all day. And I think that because the combat is so good, you feel like you're enabled to play on hard, and it feels fair even if you die. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah.
So, yeah, I think that does play into it.
You swung your sword better than me. I deserve this death.
Plus, you die with honor.
I should have threw a sticky bomb. What was I thinking?
I was so stupid. I slipped. I can't slip. I didn't freaking parry.
All right, well, speaking of ghosts, man, last night we got into that multiplayer, y'all.
Finally!
The birth of the Driptastic Four.
Yeah.
I'm pulling my chair up. Oh, yes!
Drip it, baby.
Drip sauce.
Strike a pose.
We struck so many poses, dude.
So many.
Man, funny thing was trying to execute a simultaneous assassin from the top of the cliff. Oh, my God.
Man, we did so much fun shit. Like, playing as four players through that survival mode. What'd y'all think? I had a blast.
Yeah, that's the way it's meant to be played.
Yeah.
Like, I can't see playing, doing survival without four players.
You know what I'm still tripping on, though? How all four of us simultaneously, I mean, obviously you two work with each other, and then Derek and I work with each other, but we picked completely different. There's only four classes, and we represented one of the each four classes.
Each class was represented. Like, it was destined to happen.
It was destiny, for sure.
It was destiny. Yeah.
No, it wasn't Destiny. That game
it was
sucks,
Destiny.
No, I mean, no. It was
the
Ghost.
Aura of Faith.
It was Destiny too, baby.
But yeah, that was great how we all had the different class represent. And then the next thing that was amazing too, like we never gamed up before together.
Nah,
and first time we like successfully done 15 in a row, like back-to-back-to-back. I was like, damn, we are legit.
No, and I love how some of the synergy between our classes work. Like you'd have a more melee-style class just putting in work in the circle. I'm up on a roof striking a silhouette, just headshot, I got you, headshot, I got you, boy. Then we all get so murked. AD rolls in like, revive! Everybody comes up, all of a sudden we all disappeared.
Epic,
dude, it was tight, for real.
I sliced this one dude, he fell to the floor, and I saw this dude to my right. All I see is an arrow just light by, like, pass by my head. I was like, what the hell is that? And then he's like, I was like, damn.
And I just love the variety in which they say it.
Yeah.
Dosho?
Sometimes it's a question mark, too, right?
Dosho?
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 Dosho? Oh, man. But no, us clowning around last night, man. The Mishikawa jokes had me fucking rolling around. Tomoe was the worst roommate. Wait, didn't you say that you reheated soup for 10 minutes without the lid on? Oh, yes, I did that the one time. I borrowed her shoes.
All this past secrets coming up.
Oh, man. I was like, no wonder Tomoe hates your ass, man. You sound like the worst.
Yeah, he's just talking shit about her every mission.
I know.
Every mission you learn some bullshit. He doesn't.
I used to flush the toilet when she was in the shower.
Then you meet up with Tomoe, and she's like, did he tell you that he ate my fucking leftovers? Did he tell you that? No, he didn't. What you got to say about that, Ishikawa? She murdered people. You ate her leftovers.
Right.
Not only that, he ate the skin off the fried chicken.
Meal.
He ate all the skins off the fried chicken? What's wrong with you?
Oh,
what?
Come on now.
You just left the meat? Come on.
It is my favorite portion.
I always take a big piece of chicken. I am sensei.
Yeah, but you know the skin is just flour, right?
That's it.
It's legit.
Yeah, so, I mean, if you can't already tell from the way it's coming through, y'all need to get on that Ghost of Tsushima. Yes. For real.
Yep.
That free update is... Oh, yeah, they crushed it. They crushed it, man. Yeah, I have proven that, like, you can support a game post-game and not bleed somebody dry for, like, microtransactions and all that.
That's the best part.
Them vanity items we get for free, just unlocking them.
Yeah. And, dude, we were, like, scanning... We were scanning through afterwards of, like, what you could unlock once you do the raids.
Mm-hmm.
And... Dude, the epic gear that's ahead is... You thought we had drip sauce before? Just wait.
Oh, it's about to get real drippy, baby.
It's about to be having gallons of drip sauce everywhere, boy.
You will get wet. You may get drenched.
I have them things attached to my belt. I got gallons of drip sauce here, folks. $5.99.
Right, a bucket.
A bucket. Let's move on to gaming news then. So I don't know if y'all heard about this, but Minecraft Steve, he got nerfed, y'all. He ain't even been out, but what, like a week or two?
Yeah.
I think like 11 days. His meat got nerfed.
Damn.
In the win screen. So apparently when you win a match as Minecraft Steve, he's holding the meat that he would eat during his taunt, but it kind of looks like he's holding something else, if you know what I mean.
It's like he's holding his meat.
But like he's holding his Steven meat, baby. So I see why they removed it, but
they took his manhood away. Damn.
Exactly. Man. So what I'm
I just like how Nintendo thinks they're slick.
Yeah.
Sakurai thinks he's slick.
I know. Didn't he say that he couldn't have Mai because she was too sexy? And everybody's like, what about Bayo, though? And he's going to put Steve's meat in. We see you, Sakurai. Mm-hmm. We see you. Speaking of Nintendo, though, the original Fire Emblem game way back from the 80s that never got localized with Marth in it, Shadow Dragon and Blade of Light, that's being re-released December 4th for $5.99. You can get the special edition with an NES cart reprint for $50 if you're just feeling that game that way. But here's what's messed up. I'm going to get it because I feel like of all retro games, tactics RPGs probably age the best. Like, I still dig Shining Force. You know what I mean? Like, those type of games are pretty good. It's only available until March 31st. They're pulling that Mario crap with us again.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
And it's digital. Ain't no reason to pull it off the shelf. Why are they Disney vaulting us, man? Yeah, just leave it there. What's wrong with you?
He said Disney vaulting us. Yeah. Can we watch it? No, it's closed.
No, we pulled it to the vault. I mean,
back in 4 years.
That made sense when it was like a physical product, like a VHS tape. Like, all right, okay, you only made so many. You're trying to drive up demand, whatever. Okay, I kind of get it. It sucks, but I get it. But digital, ain't no reason to pull that.
Yeah.
So.
Nah. That doesn't make no sense. Like, somebody could just hack in and just take it. Like, it's digital.
Yeah, that's the thing. There are fan translations out there of that game. So I don't know why they're pulling. They're giving up money that they could have gotten from somebody wanting to buy it. It's stupid.
Right. Yeah.
So it is what it is. So if you're interested in getting the official one on your Switch, make sure you grab that sometime between December 4th and March 31st.
All right. Okay. So you guys are heavy Switch players too.
Yeah.
No, Switch is probably my favorite console right now. I think I said last night it's eating my PS4's lunch. Like stuff like Ghost, you're only going to get on PS4. But if it comes down to a game that's on both. And it's not like an Outer World situation where one is definitely better than the other because the Switch version's bad. I'll usually pick Switch just because I like having that option to be mobile. You know what I mean?
Right.
Plus, it's got great first-party games. Some of my favorite games I've played in recent years, Fire Emblem Three Houses, Smash Ultimate, Mario Odyssey, Legend, Zelda Breath of the Wild, Hyrule Warriors. Like, they've all been on the Switch exclusively, and they're great. So, yeah, I'll stand for that Switch for sure.
Cool.
What y'all got on the gaming news?
Rambo.
Rumble.
My man.
Mumble Bumble.
Sly Stallone. They revealed the gameplay trailer for Mortal Kombat 11, and man, he is nice. Yeah. I don't know if you guys watched it. That man is ridiculous. We saw
yeah.
Man, his fatality where he trip over the cord, and then it has that spike thing come up, get him through the chest. He just rips their throat out. Damn.
Yeah, in the... Not the most recent remake, because there's been like, not remakes, but the most recent up-to-date Rambo. There was the, I think it was just called Rambo that came out after the third one back in like, 10 years ago?
Uh-huh.
He ripped somebody's throat out in that. It was crazy. I think it was like the leader of the camp that he was going to save people at.
Yeah.
And I was just like, yeah, but with his bare hands, I was like, whoa!
Yeah, and that I've seen every single one except for...
the most recent one?
Yeah, it's most recent.
I haven't seen that one either.
Yeah, First Blood was probably my favorite one out of all.
Oh, yeah. It's in a league of its own. Like, First Blood... I like a good action flick that's also a drama. There was a lot more stakes in First Blood because it felt so personal, you know?
Yeah.
And I'm going to miss something right now, man. I can't get through that ending monologue in the police station without crying, man. When he's talking about his friend dying. And he's like, and then nobody will help. And then we'll help. And I was like,
nobody will help. And I was just kind of,
nobody will help.
I was like, man, well, I would have helped you, man. I would have helped you pick your friend up. Oh, buddy.
I'm about to make my wife watch Rambo.
Where were you?
Yeah. Where were you?
Where were you?
Give that man the Oscar.
He was I wasn't like, bored yet.
I can't even get a job washing cars. Oh, man. But no, it was the whole series is cool. I really dug it. And I like how Rambo 4 kind of trying to bring it back and be a little bit more emotional like First Blood. It didn't obviously didn't get anywhere near it, but it was not as cartoony as like Rambo 2 and 3. Yeah. So
yeah, with the extra bullets. Non-stop bullets.
Also, Rambo 4 gave us that great meme, the one where he's behind the machine gun and you shoot a bunch of likes out. I love that meme.
Yeah.
I use that all the time, like super like.
Yeah, speaking of Mortal Kombat 11, you know Mortal Kombat 11 Ultimate is coming out on PS5. Mm-hmm. But there's going to be a collector's edition that has a full-size Sub-Zero mask.
Oh.
And it looks so sexy.
Oh.
And you know, Scorpion's been getting all the love, and they're finally giving Sub-Zero some. I don't understand that.
I always thought like Sub-Zero was way better.
Yeah. Really? I mean, what's cooler than being cool?
Exactly.
Sub-Zero.
What's cooler than ice, boy?
Sub-Zero, baby.
All right. Yeah, so. Let's see. What's next? We got a... Watch Dogs fans, you got Aiden Pierce is showing up as a playable character in Watch Dogs Legion, if you care. Mike said he's a bit of a wet blanket, but he's older now, and he's got some gray.
He's even wetter. Yeah, he's even wetter. He's
older and wetter. Yeah.
He's dripping,
the wetter,
baby.
The better.
Yeah.
Dripping all over.
He's going to trip all over that Watch Dogs, baby.
Yeah, but he is going to have his own little storyline to fit in with Watch Dogs Legion, which I think is pretty cool, so.
Yeah, for fans. Like I was, I was hating on him earlier. But if you're a fan, that's cool. More is always better. So give it to us.
Yes.
Which Watch Dogs y'all like the most?
Watch Dogs 2.
Yeah, for sure.
Only played like 2 hours of Watch Dogs 1 and a few minutes of Watch Dogs 2.
Watch Dogs 2. I finished Watch Dogs 1 and I got like halfway through Watch Dogs 2. I need to finish it. But the reason why I like it better, even though I haven't finished it, is because it's a little more cartoony, but the characters are like a little more, I don't know, bombastic. Like they're a little bit more fun to follow. Yeah. It gets, I don't know, just more personality in that game, I guess. I don't know how to explain it. So.
Nicole, I'm sorry. I didn't mean for this to happen.
I'm going to hack the planet.
I don't want to tell
you. I want my watchdogs to be more like hackers. You know, I want like Matthew Leard to jump in like, oh, I'm a serial killer. You know, like I want, what's this giant pink book? Oh, that's the red shirt book. That's for NSA codes. I want like goofy, stupid hacking stuff. Mm-hmm. I want somebody to be like, rabbits, flu shots, somebody talk to me.
That was there. Brilliant.
Yeah.
Man, Hackers was so, it's my favorite stupid movie of all time. I watch that all the time. That's stupid.
I don't think I've ever seen it.
I'm going to loan it to you because that movie is dumb and I love it.
Oh, I will say that I did finally pick up There Will Be Blood.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
But I see that it's like a 3-hour movie, so I don't even know if that's ever going to happen.
I don't know. Is it actually 3 hours, though?
You got to watch that in seconds.
It's like 170, 180 minutes.
All right. Well, here's
that.
What you do, man. You go into the side room, okay, where you got that CRT on the stand, and you roll it out during lunch break, okay? And then you watch that, so that way the teacher doesn't have to work. She can take a nap. And then you just finish that movie a half hour at a time, like you would at school.
Oh, okay.
There you go.
Segments.
There you go, segments.
All right.
Okay.
Chop that bad boy up.
So we got some Uncharted news. Mm. They tweeted out a picture of Tom Holland as Nathan Drake.
Mm.
So it is official. Tom Holland is young Nathan Drake. And how do we feel about it?
He looked very serious in that photo.
I haven't seen him.
You haven't seen him? Look it up real quick.
I will Google. If you hear keystrokes, because my keyboard is very loud, it's because I'm Googling a Tom Holland and Nathan Drake.
I can't see him as Nathan Drake, man.
Yeah, I mean, here's
To me, Nathan Drake is like older, and it seemed like Tom Holland is not. I don't know, he just don't look Nathan Drake to me.
Yeah, he doesn't look Drakey. Definitely don't look drippy.
He's lacking the drip.
He may not be drippy, but he's moist. I'm looking at him. You know what I'm saying?
I mean, he looks just like Uncharted 3 Drake.
I mean, he don't make me moist. The only white man ever make me moist was Tom Selleck. Tom Selleck with that mustache. That's the white man that make me moist.
I thought it was Mike Douglas.
Oh, Mike Douglas make me moist. Oh, Mike Douglas all day. Oh, man. Oh, he was on. Damn, Moore, get on top of me. Oh, Mike Douglas.
Strip of mine.
Hey, on the real, though, Tom Holland's an actor. And I'm going to give him the benefit of the doubt because he's really good in Spider-Man.
I prefer that
this movie came out 10 years ago and Nathan Fillion was the star. Oh, Nathan Fillion, a fat package.
That's the perfect Nathan Drake.
Yeah. Oh, for sure, for sure. Did y'all ever see that short that he did as Nathan Drake? Man,
yeah, it was perfect.
Yes, come on now. Nice. He needs to be in that movie. He needs to be Sully or somebody. He needs to be in that movie.
I think he might be Sully. There's a picture of him and Tom Holland.
What?
On set. So
he's got to
be Sully.
What? They say Sully is the Mark Wahlberg. It's Sully, yeah. Without the mustache, too.
Mark Wahlberg.
Without the mustache.
Yeah.
Wait, so he's going to be like a Boston Sully? He's like, hey, what's going on, Nathan Drake? You're going to be hugging for some jewels? That's great. Hey, Nathan,
say hello to your mother for me.
Say hello to your mother, Nathan.
Nice talking to you. Keep your hands out of my pockets.
Can you just quiet? Let me think. Can I think for a second?
Listen, everything's fine. Put away your gun. I got my donkeys. I voted. It's everything's fine.
Okay. Everything's fine. All right. I got my bear.
All right. Well, again, they're actors. I'll give them the benefit of the doubt. But, yeah. I mean, it could be worse. I can think of worse casting choices than Tom Holland. He's looking all right in this picture. I don't know.
I can't think of worse than Mark Wahlberg, though.
Nah.
Carrot
for
Top.
Sully?
Yeah.
Oh, Carrot Top would be worse than
Carrot Top.
Yeah. Yeah.
It could always
Buff
be
Carrot
worse.
Top? I don't know.
You know, but at least, I mean, I like Mark Wahlberg. Even if he's not perfect for the Sully role, at least, you know, he's charismatic. Like, I mean, he might be able to bring something to the role that could still make the movie work, even if he's not strictly the Sully that you know, know and love, so to speak. Right. So I'm trying to stay positive, y'all.
Nathan?
Nathan.
He always sounds like that because he got a damn cigar in his mouth. Take that shit out of your mouth before you talk to him, man.
Hey, kid, come on. Yeah, let's look for some treasures, kid.
Yeah,
come on,
kid, treasures, she.
Exactly. I know he's going to do that.
All right.
But, yeah, I'll wait for the trailer. It all depends on the trailer.
Yeah. Oh, speaking of trailers, did you guys see the Monster Hunter World or Monster Hunter trailer?
Yes.
Oh, yes, I did.
Looked yeah, up. We were talking about that question. Last week.
We talked about that last week?
Yeah, yeah, okay. we did talk about that last week. What'd you think about it?
Why Paul Wes Anderson always create these game-adapted movies, but always flip the story to something new rather than actual going to the story adaptation?
We talked about that last week.
Yeah.
My theory is, and this goes all the way back to Resident Evil and how different of a movie that was in the script. You know, because originally George Romero wrote the original script, and the studio was like, nah. And they kept getting it rewritten, and they finally found a director that would let them interfere to make the movie have more, like, mass appeal. And you know, when a studio gets too involved, that's usually the downfall of a movie, especially when it comes from a pre-existing IP. Yeah. So Paul W.S. Anderson is the type of dude where he's a competent director. I mean, he made Event Horizon. That was great. He made Mortal Kombat. Yeah. That was awesome. But he's also very easily influenced by, you know, studios and their money. So if they come in like, nah, change this, he's like, okay, pretty much. And then, of course, you know, he fell in love with and met his wife during Resident Evil and put her in all his shit since. She would have been in Mortal Kombat for sure if they'd already been married.
Wow.
Yeah. So, but yeah, I think it's just because he's easily influenced by studios. Now, we talked about how the fish out of water story is kind of lame, but it does help narratively for a movie to get people up to speed. And I'm happy that at the very least, they brought in some original people from the Monster Hunter world, like Tony Jaa. So that way you still have some people that are familiar with that world and live within it. And it's not just the military versus monsters, no other people.
Right.
So at least there's that. I'm trying to look for a silver lining here.
You're a very positive man when you look at these things.
I'm trying to
keep you positive.
It's 2020, man. If I think too hard, I'll start crying. I got to stay positive. I can't go outside. I miss people.
You got to stay moist.
Right.
I haven't hugged anyone but my son and my wife for a year, and I'm not saying that that's a bad thing, but come on, man.
I need to hug others.
I got to spread this love out around here.
Yeah, you guys ever be out and somebody like, try to shake your hand, and then you awkwardly go in for the handshake, and you're like, should we be doing this?
Yeah. I'm not sure this is allowed, but I missed contact.
Elbow.
Oh, that's an opportunity to be like, psych, and then like rub your hair like people do.
Old school.
Take it back in the
90s. No, I don't think
it, Mike.
Be like, coronavirus, the shit is real.
Well, anybody else got any news before we talk about this 2K21 nonsense?
I'm tapped out on news, baby.
Yeah, that's all the news I got.
Okay, so it has been reported that NBA next gen versions of NBA 2K21 will have unskippable ads.
Motherfucker.
Unskippable ads. What the hell are they going to have us sit through the ads for?
So they can get money. What you mean?
2K always been thirsty. They always been thirsty.
Yeah,
man.
This is a new level, though.
It is next level, for sure.
Yeah, because, like, we already didn't like seeing... Well, I don't play 2K, but we already didn't like seeing all the advertisements and everything within the game. But now it's just, I'm assuming, like, when you hit a timeout or something, they're going to start playing ads and shit.
You know what the worst thing is?
So it's like a real basketball game?
Yeah.
The worst thing is...
We're immersing you.
Take-Two can literally print money. I mean, they've made so much off of Grand Theft Auto V and the online. They're making so much off of these sports franchises. Like, they can print money. They're one of the richest, you know, like, video game production studios there is. And yet they're still pushing the envelope on this stupid shit. UFC had like the boys ads in them. And the boys ain't a bad show, but I ain't trying to have that in my video. Let me just
Nobody
play video
games.
Nobody
wants ads in their video games, bro.
Yeah.
Why?
And the thing is, you can do product placement in a video game and end up being like unobtrusive and kind of cheeky. Like, I don't mind if I'm playing a shooter and I go past like, I don't know, like a soda machine and it's a Coke machine. Cool. Right. Coke gave you some money. Great.
Excellent.
Whatever. That's fine. But, you know, unless it's like a fantasy shooter that's in another world and they have Coke too, don't do that shit.
Don't do that. That makes no sense at all.
But I'm hoping this will be the last straw for a lot of gamers. And they're like, nah, we ain't doing this. Because they're really preying on people's love for basketball. And the love is real for a lot of people. You know what I mean?
It is.
Really real.
We talked about last week how they just kind of basically released the same FIFA game every year. So much so that IGN was like, oh, you're going to copy and paste the game? We're going to copy and paste last year's review. So, pretty I mean, much. People are noticing.
It's the same thing with Madden, too. Like, Madden's always copy and paste, bro.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Like, so. You just update the roster and say we did one thing differently, like the iPhone, and there you go. There's your game.
Slightly better graphics.
And they get away with it because they have a monopoly on the license. No one else can come in and like use those teams. Yep. And that's what happens with monopolies, man.
Although, so, I will say, I've seen comparison of graphics between PS4 version and PS5 version.
PS5. Mm.
It's like night and day.
Mm.
Yeah, dude.
Mm. Like... Yeah. Yeah, it's crazy. The sweat is real.
Like race car sims.
The sweat is seriously real in that game, dog.
And sports sims, they always push the envelope of graphics. So the first ones you're going to see the really good graphics typically are like your sports games and your racing games. Mm-hmm. So I believe it. I really do.
But I think because of how real the sweat is on the PS5 for that game, that's why they wanted to add the ads. They're like, we need everything of basketball real.
They were like, these motherfuckers can't resist the drip. It's too drippy, baby.
They're gonna sit through. If they want to see more drip, you're gonna watch these ads, sucker.
That's right.
I want to see more drip.
Feed me, see more drip.
Oh man, speaking of drippy, baby, Derek, I got one question that I've been waiting a whole week to ask you. It's just been burning in my mind. I forgot about it all last night, but I need to ask you now. This week, Derek, what you feeling?
I am feeling a YouTube channel by the name of Pretty Much It. And it's two guys. They usually have guests on, but they do commentary tracks on movies and shit.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just fucking hilarious. They have one where they do the entire Harry Potter series. And you can go to their website and like download the full commentary track. They just give you little snippets on YouTube. But I watch them every day. Cool. I watch the same videos over and over.
Have you ever actually grabbed like a full commentary and watched a movie with it? Have you tried that out?
Hell no.
I ain't trying to watch There Will Be Blood for 3 hours with commentary.
I ain't got that much money, player.
Ayo, speaking of commentary, one of the best commentary tracks I've heard in a long time was the commentary for Get Out. Jordan Peele did it himself. Mm-hmm. So that got me to watch that movie for like the fifth time. So if y'all have Get Out on Blu-ray or DVD, likely you probably have. I was disappointed because I got the Blu-ray for us and he didn't do the commentary again. I was like, damn, man. This is the one movie I wanted you to explain, fool.
He's like, it wasn't as good. I'm not going to comment.
I enjoyed Us a lot, but you're right. Like, Get Out was just in a different league. It was tight. Yeah. There was no fan on Get Out. Cold and bloody.
I'm mad at Winston the Dukes. Copy. Ooh.
Dude, on SNL they had that where, like, you know how they have those phone commercials where you call and your like twin is talking. So they had her like, oh, you can get your phone bill cheaper. And then like, and then the husband on there like, let me talk to him, like, hey, who is this? And he goes, oh.
Hell yeah. Oh man.
Oh, the SNL skit was so good. Let's move it along then. AD, this week, what you feeling?
Feeling this Halloween costume I got going on.
Oh,
it's
shit.
It's going to be a Black Ash Ketchum.
Wait, a Black Ash Ketchum?
Black Ash Ketchum. I can't
Black
say that
Ash Ketchum.
Black Ash Ketchum?
What's an Ash Ketchum?
Did you say Black Ass Ketchup? No, I said Black Ass Ketchum. Man, Black Ass Ketchum.
This is spicy as hell. This is some Black Ass Ketchum.
Just came out with a new ketchup, folks. Black ass ketchup.
Hey. Trademark that shit immediately. That's going to sell.
I'm going to trademark it. I'm going to put that advertisement in the new 2K. Watch.
I see that thing coming out soon. The mascot's going to be a generic looking black
ass ketchup. I got the wig. I ironed my clothes. I got my gloves and my Pokemon book bag. So I'm ready to go.
Nice.
Son's going to be Pikachu. So I taught him Volt Tackle last night. So I'm like, you got to run and charge into them kids when you see them taking the candy, right?
How old
run
is your
and
son?
Charge. He's two. He got it.
Oh, that's perfect.
He's all right. It's perfect.
So
he's on all fours.
Is he a fan of Pokemon?
Yeah. Not really. He not barely really, knows no. how to. I taught him how to say Pika at least, so he was working with that. So I was like, all right, Pika and Volt Tackle. We good.
So isn't it great teaching kids how to say nerd shit?
Oh, right? It's the best.
Start them early, bro. Start them early.
I taught my goddaughter how to say Hadouken. She'd be like, Hadouken. Oh.
Ben used to say Hadouken all the time. He loved it. It made him giggle. Because we used to, when Smash Ultimate was about to come out, we used to watch that trailer that would introduce all the characters. He knew all their names. I have video of him at 2 years old screaming out their names when they came on screen. I was like, yes!
Victory!
Super
victory right there.
Yeah. But it's funny. Your kid goes from like really outgoing to shy, you know, somewhere around 2 to 3, it seems like, for a lot of kids at least. That happened to my kid. So he was really shy when he was 3, and I had him in his Charizard outfit, and I got him out of being shy because he knew about Pokemon, being like, I would go, Charizard, you scary face. And then all of a sudden he'd go, rah. And
it was, nice.
Yeah. And then, because I couldn't get him to pose for pictures unless I made him use a move. So, yeah. Of course. And,
so you gotta get into character.
Of course, I did that around when they were playing the Pokemon card game at Gen Con, and somebody called out, like, why would you teach your Charizard scare? I was like, you shut up.
you shut your face.
It doesn't do anything.
It's pointless. It's wasting a move slot.
Should take that out, teach him to fly.
Right.
I'm like, bro, if you keep doing that, you're never going to have any kids.
Nope.
Right. And why do I have to teach my flying Pokemon fly?
Yeah. The last thing I got to get, though, I got to pick up. I'm trying to get at least 4 Pokeballs to attach to my belt buckle.
I wish you were local, buddy. I would loan you my Pokedex. Actually, Derek, don't you have a Pokedex?
I sold it already.
Yeah.
I was going to say, you could next day air Amazon Prime,
baby. Yeah, next day, boy. Use that same skill that you just got. Send that to me.
Man, I can't wait. Definitely post up pictures. We want to check that out.
Yeah.
And the next cool part, too, like, it's me, him, my wife decided to dress up as Nurse Joy. So it's going to be a full decked out.
Oh,
family
man.
Of Pokemon.
Yeah. I'm excited. I can't wait. That
Don't
sounds awesome.
Around, let there be a Brock around.
Oh hell, thirsty Brock.
Nurse Joy! Hey, Pikachu! Volt tackle right now. Pikachu!
Oh, that ain't going to stop his thirsty ass. Right. He's drippy, baby.
He's boy, dripping all over the place. Open your eyes. Open your eyes, Brock.
Right. Are you black or Asian? What's happening? All
right,
and you know what? Just for the hell of it, I'm going to put black ass ketchup in my pocket, too.
There you go. Black ass ketchup, yo.
Black ass ketchup.
So, GP, this week, I want to know.
Yeah.
What you feeling?
I'm feeling a Swamp Thing. I'm late in the game and watching it. I know it's only season 1, so I'm checking it out on CW. It was on DC app, so that's what I'm checking out. It's nice. I like the story. It's a little blend of the CDC working on the virus.
Which virus?
A virus. Which virus exactly? A plant virus.
The
plant
virus.
You need to be careful with that virus, folks.
So in the show, does that mean there's like more than one Swamp Thing, or you could become a Swamp Thing, or how's that work? I didn't really follow the comics.
Oh, this one is one Swamp Thing, and it's like various of people becoming infected with the virus, so it's they're becoming monsters themselves. So,
cool. So does it have like the lore of the green and everything?
Yep.
Like that. Yeah. Okay. Dope.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yep. Sounds like the new age virus we're going through right now.
Basically,
everybody becoming monsters.
Selfish ass monsters at that. All right. Well, before it gets too real, you guys may be wondering, what am I feeling this week? Let me tell you.
Feeling?
This week, I am feeling a podcast. It's up and coming. It's funny. It's got 2 dope hosts. It's called Call It Like I Don't See It.
2 dope hosts.
That's right.
I heard of that.
A couple of cool guys from Houston, man, named AD and GP. So I started listening to y'all's show, I want to say like a month ago, maybe 2 months ago. I can't remember now. But, you know, I got pretty much all the way caught up. And I'm digging your style. I really am. That's why I wanted to reach out to you guys, maybe get you on the show and do some cross promoting. But I like the format. I like the musical cues. I like positive chakra.
Chakra, baby.
So got a lot of really fun, like, recurring segments. And I think, you know, for those out there listening, if you're a fan of our show, if you're into it, you know, follow these guys on Twitter. We'll give you all a chance, of course, to plug all your stuff. But yeah, I just want to say that right now, you know, I'm always on the hunt for new comedians, new podcasts, you know, new YouTube channels, any personalities I can get out there that I vibe with. And I'm vibing with y'all. So I really appreciate that you came on the show today.
Thank you,
appreciate
man.
Appreciate it. Yeah. We vibe with you, too.
All right.
I'm about to cry.
Don't cry, G. You got to keep that shit together.
Hey,
travel all the way out of here for nothing. Yeah,
right. That's right. Y'all in the studio, the virtual studio.
Yeah, virtual studio.
Cool. Well, we would usually around this time feel our power levels rising for the Derek X Mike anime channel. Whoa, no, hold on, stop. Can't do that this week. Because we got guests and because it's October, I thought it might be a good time for us to sit down and just reflect back on what would be our favorite scary video games of all time, or video games that really scared us personally. So that's kind of what I want to discuss this week. And just to kick it off, what's one game that immediately comes to mind that you know for sure is like one of the scariest games you ever played?
Dead Space.
Damn.
Number one.
Dead Space.
No hesitation.
No hesitation on that.
The space is dead. So what's the scariest thing about Dead Space, do you think?
The ambiance, man.
Yeah.
The sound design is ridiculous.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm so mad that they shut that studio down.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Fucking EA.
EA.
Challenge everything.
EA is the worst. So, yeah, I agree.
But yeah, the sound design, the creature design was really good, too.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I like the conceit of, like, you know how you're trained in all these games, especially survival horror games, to aim for the head, right?
Yeah.
And Dead Space is like, okay, don't do that, though, because if you do, and I made the mistake of doing it early on in that game, it just frenzies the monsters and makes them harder to kill.
Yeah.
You got to separate the limbs.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I got to agree. I think the thing that stands out about Dead Space the most is the sound design. I think it really sets you on edge and creeps you out. I think a good scary game isn't constant jump scares. And it isn't just constant creep. There's a good mix of the two. And Dead Space is really good at putting you in that headspace, for lack of a better term, to be prepared to get just the shit scared out of you. You know what I mean? Like, you're always on edge. You're hearing voices. You're hearing weird stuff. And that's the other thing, too. The cool thing about this story is it's kind of like Event Horizon almost, whereas that ship went to hell and back. With this one, you have the planet cracker, Ishimura, right?
Yeah.
And they go into a planet and they receive this, they find this marker, this weird alien object. It actually emanates these, like, psychic waves that make people crazy and turn them into monsters. So the entire time you're hearing all these voices, it's probably the influence of this marker. It's all, like, in universe and makes sense. Mm-hmm. And it's just the perfect setting to freak you out. And you in space. In space, There's no McDonald's. There's no Sonic. There's no bacon butter garlic burger.
No!
That's the scariest thing of all.
That's the scariest part.
In space, no one can hear you say garlic bacon butter burger.
Get me out of here.
But yeah, the thing that I love about Dead Space is that it makes you, like, you know you have the tools to get past any challenge, but you're still fucking scared.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yeah. That's a hard balance to strike.
Yeah, Isaac is damn near OP with his weapons.
Mm-hmm.
If you know how to use them. But even so, you walk down that corridor, you hear that.
You don't know where is that. Like, what is that?
And then it's literally nothing. It's just the old ship, like, breaking down.
Mm-hmm.
And then immediately after, they hit you with that jump scare.
Mm-hmm.
And plus, he's not a hero. He's just an engineer looking for his girlfriend. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. Yep. And it's one of the few times that I like a silent protagonist.
Yeah. He was silent until what?
The sequel.
Two?
Yeah, then he started talking.
I wish he was silent the whole time, really.
Yeah, me too. I dug that more, definitely. Cool. What other games come to mind, y'all think? I was thinking about Silent Hill. Y'all ever play that?
No. Yeah, I played the first one, yeah.
Silent Hill, my favorite probably about all the bunch. Really, I think it's just the first four games that you can count, because after that, they switched it off to other developers and studios and just kept the name. But Silent Hill 3 was probably the scariest of that bunch that I've played. It really freaked me out. And again, sound design plays a huge part. The music and the sound effects that they place in that game constantly put you on edge. And combat really isn't that tough. but they still find a way again to get you in that headspace and get you really scared. And it is still a lot harder than Dead Space because, yeah, you're right. Isaac's got that arsenal. You're over the shoulder. It's a little bit easier to fight. And to Silent Hill, you got to fight that camera angle. You're slow to like bring up, and you really are like no expert. So you can miss. You can run into walls on accident. All kinds of stuff. So
yeah.
I had another one. This one's not. This was a serious throwback there, but it's. I'm talking about from the Game Boy Advance days.
Mm-hmm.
Metroid Fusion. Mm-hmm. Y'all ever played that?
Fusion.
No, Metroid I haven't Fusion. Played it. No.
The one where Samus, like, she lost her powers in the beginning. It's space, right? She's on this ship that's, like, hella ruined. There's a bad version of Samus that's super OP.
Mm.
And, like, you gotta hide from this thing anytime you see it. Like, the screen's black and just the circle of light would just be on you on the screen.
Mm.
And anytime this character came on, it's like, dude, you gotta hide because as soon as you pop out, she's gonna kill you. So, and then the sound effects is all like, dun, 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 dun. I'm like, oh, bro, get me out of here. Get me the hell off this shit. Make him murder, 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 murder. And then it didn't help. You know, Game Boy Advance, you know, the handheld game. So I'm like under my covers playing it and stuff. I'm like, dude,
no,
I'm surrounded by darkness. Yeah. It is so bad. But yeah, that the ambiance and stuff and the space, that thing really freaked me out when I was playing it. That was the first thing that came to mind.
Another game I liked that was... To me, it was horrible. Well, the first one was BioShock.
Mm. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I love that game.
That's got a good vibe, too. It's very, very unique world that they built for that game, for sure.
This one looked like he's just had his cherry popped.
Here comes the big daddy. I was
like,
daddy.
Oh, really?
That dude's like,
yeah, and then just like, hearing the big daddy's like moaning in the distance.
Yeah.
Ooh, and you're like, fuck.
Like, don't come chasing me, man. Please.
Right. Though. Yeah, well, speaking of games with scary parts, that reminds me of Resident Evil 4. The whole game wasn't scary, although there were definitely tense moments, like when you first get in the village and that everybody's chasing after you, including that chainsaw guy that can like one hit kill you.
Yeah.
But the thing that freaked me out the most was when you get to the part with the regenerators. You remember those?
Mm-hmm.
They breathe like, you know, they're around the corner because the music kicks in and then you hear this. And then when you shoot them, they just keep coming at you. And the thing is, when they get you, they like jump, they get up in the camera so you see their face and they're just biting on your neck like, rawr, 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 and like, ah! You don't actually have an effective means of defeating them until you get past your first one and you get that infrared scope. And then you can see where the plagas are and they're by to shoot them out. But even then, if you're not a good shot, they're slow walking towards you like Jason, like, I'm going to get that ass. You better shoot this thing. You better hope that you upgraded your sniper rifle because this plagas is on the back of my leg, baby. You got to get around behind me, baby. And then by the time you do, it's just gnawing on your neck.
So nibbling.
What's your thoughts on Village, the new one coming out?
Oh, I'm so hyped for that.
I'm actually interested. And I don't even get down with Resident Evil like that.
Yeah,
they're making Chris Redfield feel like he's an antagonist, right?
A villain.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, a little bit. A villain. That's going to be interesting to see.
It's like, Chris, what the fuck? I thought we was boys.
I mean, you know, it's not the first time they've done that.
My dog.
I mean, it could either be like in Resident Evil 5, where like, you know how like Jill Valentine was under the influence, right?
Yeah.
Or it could be that it seems like he's a villain, but really he's like either undercover or the real villain is who you think is the good guy. Like it could be like a flip. Who knows what they're going to do with it, but
yeah.
I'm excited. Squad. Yeah. They asked me, what you going to do about it? I said, well, flipping on them. Flip most squad. Right. Flip most squad's greatest.
Flip bowl!
As a shorty, I knew if I wasn't going to be part of the greatest,
I'd become greatest the myself.
Greatest. Yeah, come on. So.
Real, what a surprise.
Come on.
Capitalize. Come on. That little small guy, we on the rise. I do that whole album. Busta Rhymes, like, to get on a side tangent, the first, like, hip-hop artist I followed, like, album to album when I was young was Busta Rhymes. Like, I was into him. Them first three albums, up until, like, the year 2000, The Coming, When Disaster Strikes, and Extinction Level Event, you can't fuck with them albums, man.
So you were dead. Yeah.
Derek seen me do that on karaoke. Oh, yo, when I come up in the room, you are going to be red. You are a chair. Hey, yo, hey.
That super camera zooming on your face.
Yeah, the fisheye lens.
I don't think Buffy is nowhere near the
like
credit.
Like Calypso. Man, because he can make a whole motherfucking song rhyme, y'all. Like, that's what I was really into. I was like, this guy's got a good flow. So,
yeah.
Anyways, getting back off of that. I liked how you brought up, AD, I think it was you were talking about Metroid Fusion, right?
Yeah.
I liked how you brought up a non-traditional scary game that has scary parts. Can you guys think of any other games that are not technically horror games that had really scary parts that, like, freaked you out?
Well, I'm thinking, was Last of Us 2, was that horror or just zombie?
I mean, it was definitely more drama. Like, I wouldn't, but I mean, it had a lot of scary parts for sure.
It had scary parts in that.
It make you tense.
Rat King, forget about it.
That Rat King, fuck that Rat King.
I was super tense because GP was streaming when he was playing Last of Us 2. I freaking jumped back in my seat for a couple of months. I was like, what the hell is that thing screeching at you like that? Run!
Yeah, it was funny. The very first part when you still have the horse, my cousin popped into the stream. He was like, hey, man, how you liking this game? He had already beaten it. I was like, oh, yeah, you know, it's cool. Because the horse got blown up. And he was just cracking up because he knew what was about to happen to me. And I was like, it's just chilling. It's we in Seattle. We out here looking at coffee shops and picking up shit, you know.
Now that hospital scene, man, that hospital, Abby goes to that other side of the hospital.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
That beast that's morphing to all of
that's
those.
The Rat King, ain't it?
The Rat King.
That's the Rat King?
Yeah.
Oh, man, that dude, damn, man. That was scary, man.
Yeah, no, I actually. That was scary. I need to go back to my stream and watch that fight. And y'all can too. Yeah. MC Paper Stacks plays on YouTube. But that part was really tense. And I remember there was somebody that had already played the game commenting. He was like, you need to go this way or that way. You never turn off your flashlight. And I'm like, shut up.
Let me play.
I can't focus. Because I don't know if you ever stream, you try to read the comments and play a really tense moment at the same time. It's hard.
Yeah.
Just don't do it.
Yeah.
Well, cool.
I've gotten scary beatdowns before, that's for sure.
Mm-hmm. Right.
It's fighting games.
Well, I really liked, I'll mention Until Dawn, because I think it's worth mentioning for anybody that's ever played. It's really easy to get a hold of. It's pretty cheap. It's one of the better kind of David Cage style story, like Telltale style, where you just kind of move people around and make decisions type of games. What I like about Until Dawn is it manages to jam all different types of genre of horror into it. So you got like the kids in the cabin in the woods, right? You got what could be ghosts, could be a psycho killer. That's like Saw style, could be monsters, right? Could be none of them, you know? And then you get to kind of like figure out or try to solve it. And then the whole time you're trying to keep everybody alive by your decisions. Like, people rag on David Cage games, and for good reason. There's definitely problems with them. But one of the hypest things about Heavy Rain that I really enjoyed, and what made Heavy Rain really scary for me, is just the knowledge that if I fuck up too much, my character dies. I was like, no! You know,
and the story just continues on without him.
Yeah. And that's a really cool conceit. I wish more games would do that. I mean, I know it's harder for certain types of games, but just knowing that, like, you may not make it out alive, and that doesn't mean a game over where you can start over. That just means you just move on. That's really tense.
Yeah, they always have one of those trophies where you got to keep all your characters alive throughout the whole game.
Mm-hmm. I was able to do it my second run through of Until Dawn. My first one, everybody but one person died. You know how my one person died? He died because I tried to save my girlfriend twice instead of once.
Yeah, the ultimatum. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That's the same thing happened with me when I played that game.
And I was like, come on, who would not try to save her a second time? But especially, you're supposed to look at it and go, nah, girl, I'm sorry. This is a hopeless situation. I'm going to have to let you go.
Right. You gotta let you go.
Yeah, but what you gonna do? All right, then. Well, I think that might be the show.
Yes.
That was faster than I expected.
Yeah. No, I think we talked about it before. Like, one of the first times we ever had guests on, we were expecting it to be really long, but we were so nervous about that, we just kept moving.
Yeah.
Right. I could rap with y'all all day. So again, I want to say thank you. Yeah. I really appreciate y'all coming on the show today.
Thanks for having us, man. Appreciate that.
For those who are interested, maybe want to check out your podcast, find you, you know, where can they locate you? Twitter, whatever. Why don't you give the people where they can find you at?
You go to email us at calllikeidontseeit@gmail.com, calllikeidont@ Twitter, and calllikeidontseeit@ Instagram.
Right on. All right.
All over the place.
And Derek, if people are trying to get that next Pokédex you get in, they're trying to follow you, see what you got on them pickups, man. Try to get that
Derek.
Next day Amazon, baby.
Yeah.
Where can they find you at?
They can check you out at ebay.com/str/gamergoodiesandmore. I'm on Instagram at gamergoodiesmore and Twitter at goodies_more. I got the goodies and more for you.
Oh, that was check you on Twitter?
Out. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
I was like, who this?
He's like, I'm a following.
I just saw a game, and I was like, all right, I'm a follower.
Yeah, right on, right on. All right, well, if y'all like what you're hearing, you want to hear more from me, you can follow me on Twitter at MikePetersonAL, YouTube channel MC Paper Stacks Plays, where I put all my Twitch streams. You want to catch me live on Twitch, that's twitch.tv/MCPaperStacks. On Mondays, 9 p.m. Eastern, doing Brawlers and Warriors games. Fridays, we're doing horror games at 10 p.m. Eastern. My main stream, Tuesdays, Thursdays, Saturdays at 8. Right now I'm playing Hades. You can check future uploads of the podcast every single Sunday at anchor.fm/player2hasenteredthepod. You can also catch us wherever podcasts are available. Breaker, Google Podcast, Overcast, Pocket Cast, Radio Public, Apple Podcast, and Spotify. You can email us for comments, questions, concerns, criticisms, mcpaperstacks@gmail.com. And if you're on Facebook, I do run a group, facebook.com/groups/indiegamers. And that's our show. All right. So I'd like to.
What a good one it was.
Yeah, what a great one it was. So yeah, I'd like to thank everybody for listening, and we will catch you next week. Bye bye.
Peace.
Deuces.